Okay, then I start with my today presentation. It's about Kling's QDOT backend, which enables interactive GPU development with CUDA C++. And in the beginning, I want to talk a little bit about basics, about GPU development in Kling itself, because I think many people of you are not familiar with one or the other thing. And so let's start. So the first question is why we use GPUs for development. And the answer is pretty simple. On a CPU, we have a few cores which are really flexible and strong. And on a GPU, we have many cores which are weak and not so flexible. But in sum, GPU achieves a better performance per watt like a CPU. And we can use it if our algorithm allows us, because algorithm which runs efficiency on the GPU and needs a really high level of parallelity. And why we use CUDA is also really simple, because it's the most widespread GPUs in HPC and personal computers. Okay, how it looks if we develop a GPU application in CUDA. So it's more or less really common C and C++. CUDA is a single source language, so it means we can write everything in a single file. And yeah, like this. And here we have the classic main of a C function. And in the main function, we have some functionalities to control the GPU. For example, we have a memcopy, which copies data from the CPU to GPU. Or host and device. So host means simply the CPU and device GPU in speech of CUDA. And then we have a function which executes the kernel on the GPU. And the kernel is defined in a C function with the special attribute global. And which is a little bit special for this function is we have some built-in library calls. For example, we can ask the own ID, because this function is executed many times. In this case, 32 threads on 10 blocks. So it means in total 320 times. And depending on the own ID, it do something. For example, this copies simply a vector from A to B. Yeah, and then we get the results back. And oh, and I forgot to say, if you execute a CUDA application, at first we execute it on the CPU, and the application itself is running on the CPU, and over the library function it controls the GPU. For the compiler it looks a little bit different, because this code is running on the CPU and this is running on the GPU. This means we need to compile the code for two target architectures. For example, on the x86 computer, we need to compile it to x86 assembler code. So this one. And this is compiled to PDX code, which is a kind of assembler for NVIDIA GPUs. And this have to be handled by the compiler. Okay, now some basic about the compiler pipeline, because later we'll talk about I will use these terms. So oh, and this is the compiler pipeline of Kling. So it means we have some stages which are not normal for a common compiler. So at the beginning, we have the normal input in the terminal. For my example, I use a simple function call, foo, which I defined here. And the first stage is the meta parser. The meta parser of Kling has two tasks. So one is handling so-called meta commands that could be linking shared library or some other stuff. And the other task is do a source code transformation. For example, we need to wrap up this function call in a wrapper function, because function calls in the C++ global space are forbidden. Okay, after we have the modified C++ code, we send it to the parser, and the parser transforms the C++ code to a so-called as to a abstraction syntax tree, or short AST. This is an internal representation for the compiler, and the compiler can do many things on this. For example, some modification of the application or diagnostic, and so on. Next stage is the AST transformer, which do this modification. For example, I need a modification to enable the QDOT mode, or there are also some other modification like a null pointer access protection for Kling and other stuff. Then we have the code generator, which generates from the AST the actual machine code. In this case, it's x86 assembler, and it generates the assembler code and the object file, so in memory. And in the end, the code is executed in the executor, and we get, in this case, some output. So these are the basic stages which I need for my presentation. Okay, so now I want to talk a little bit of the challenges during development the CUDA mode, because it's nice to know for future development, and also to understand what I did. So the first problem was, in the past, is interactive CUDA C++ possible? And this question was a little bit difficult. So in general, CUDA has two APIs. One is driver API, and the other is the runtime API. The driver API is used for implementing libraries and special functionality, and for example, also used for Python bindings. And therefore, the driver API was designed for interactive usage. The runtime API, which normal C++ users uses, and I already shown in the example, was not designed for interactive usage. Luckily, I think it shares a lot of stuff under the hood with the driver API. And so with some testing, I found out that runtime API can be also used interactively. But to be honest, there's no official support for interactive stuff, so strange things can happen. Okay, the second problem was the special CUDA C++ syntax, because for example, this is the how we launch a kernel, and this errors are needed to express the level of parallelism, which is not possible with standard C or C++. Luckily, there was a project from Google called GPUCC, which implements the extensions for the Clang compiler, and we can use it for Kling. Unfortunately, the meta parser does not based on the Kling parser, and so for the meta parser, I need to write some modifications by myself. And the last thing was more or less an engineering task. So it was how to integrate the device compiler pipeline. So it means this pipeline which compiles the code for the GPU. And before my work, Kling was not able to run a second pipeline, only the first one was the CPU. Yeah. During the development, the general problem was documentation. So CUDA is proprietary, and luckily it has in general a really good documentation, but at most for users, not so for developers for some really strange stuff like compilers. And so there are some details are missing in the documentation, and I did some black box testing to find out some behavior. Yeah, then was also the documentation from Kling and Clang and LVM. So when I started with the development, I was pretty new in the LVM framework, and I have to say that LVM documentation was pretty good. And then the Clang was okay most of the time, and yeah, the Kling is really rudimentary. Yeah, and also I already mentioned it, the runtime API was not designed for interactive usage, so I needed to develop some workarounds. Okay, now let's talk about the implementation. So in this diagram, you can see the scheme of the dual compiler concept of the Kling in CUDA mode. The blocks presents different stages of the compiler pipelines and the front and back end. And the arrows shows the data flow. So in the case of Kling, it means data flow means the source code which we pass and execute in the end. And you can see the input and the source code transformation both the same for the host compiler or CPU pipeline and for the GPU pipeline. Both use the parser to parse the code. And at this stage, and say parse the whole code, so there is no difference a bit on both sides, they don't separate between host and device code. Then we have transformations on both sides. The stage difference is a little bit different for each other. So some transformations are shared between host and device, other are special for the certain pipeline. Then on the device side, we compile the code to PDX code, which is a kind of GPU assembler. And in the end, we wrap up it in a so-called fat binary wrapper. This is more or less simply a struct with some metadata and including the PDX code. This was also a special problem during my development because this struct is not official documented. Luckily, there was a project from Hal Finkel which re-implemented this struct and I can reuse. So thanks to this. Yeah, and then it's a little bit strange. The fat binary code is written to a temporary file in the temp file system. And later, if the assembler code of the host site is generated, it loads the fat binary code from a file and stored in a data section of the object file. And also on the host side, after the transformation and so on, there are also some CUDA library calls generated, which, for example, sends this PDX code to the GPU and execute it.
It's so, okay, I'm just listening.
Oh, okay. Yeah, and then we have this x86 assembler code object, which is simply executed in the normal Kling executor. And during runtime, if a CUDA library function is executed, it triggers the CUDA runtime and something happens on the GPU. Just for completeness, those are the class which are wolf for the certain stage. And this diagram shows the program flow. So you can see the whole application is running strictly sequential. So it means if the source code is go in the path of the host side, it triggers the whole compiler pipeline of the device side. So it parses the code and then generates the fat binary code. And after storing the data to the file, it goes back to the parser of the host side. And in the source code, it looks like here. So the device compiler is triggered in the Kling interpreter, in the class Kling interpreter, in the function process, parse and declare. So this is the entry point. Okay, and the compiler pipeline itself is implemented in the Kling class Kling incremental CUDA device compiler. So the class contains, in general, the compiler pipeline, but also some helper functionality. And the compiler pipeline itself is a modified class of Kling interpreter. So the interpreter is used to parse the code, the source code to AST, and then I use a custom backend to generate the PDX code and a functionality wrap up in fat binary code. Hopefully in future, I can refactor it and integrate the PDX generator in the Kling interpreter class. Yeah, and here you can see again the stages which I explained before in the diagram. Okay, so what is still working at the moment? So we have support for Kling 9 and CUDA 10.1. And so the basic stuff is working. You will see it in the live demo. Unfortunately, not all functionality, CUDA functionality is working at the moment. For example, constant memory or global device memory is not working at the moment because it needs it has some special behavior in Kling and we need to adapt it for Kling. Also, not all Kling features are working at the moment with CUDA. For example, redefinition of kernels is not possible. Yeah. The meta parser has some problems to detect valid CUDA C++ statements. So it means they are really valid, but the meta parser did not recognize it. And sometimes you have to work around it or use the raw input mode. And error catching is still a problem. I think every Kling user knows, so sometimes Kling is a little bit unstable and there are some segmentation faults for some use cases and the CUDA mode makes not better, more the opposite side. Okay, so it's time for the live demonstration. my live demonstration are orientated to our planned use cases. So we use the Kling for teaching GPU programming at the university. We used Jupyter Notebook in the GPU lectures, and it was pretty nice. We want to use Kling in future for big interactive laser plasma wake feed simulation with GPUs. So the name of the simulation is Picon GPU, which is running really well on really huge HPC systems, so the biggest on the world. But because it runs so well, we got new problems with the data, and we need some solution for this. And we want to also use it for easy development and debugging of application, and especially together with our framework Alpaca, which allows writing performance portable code. This means you can implement the kernel, you can implement your algorithm in one time with Alpaca, and then you can execute on different backends, which means on CPUs, different GPUs, or in future maybe also on FPGAs. Okay, then let's start with the demonstration. So if you want to start the CUDA mode, you have simply type CUDA minus executor. In my case, I need a little bit more complicated command for the demo and for my environment. So I need a REPL script, but it also uses the minus executor flag. And then we can simply start. And at the beginning, it's a good idea to verify if the GPU is working. So we simply call CUDA last arrow, get last arrow. And you see we get a CUDA suggest, which means the GPU is ready. Now we can simply define a kernel. So for example, this kernel simply returns a value to a single value. So the answer. And now we need simply some memory on the GPU. Unfortunately, the CUDA API is pure C, so it looks not so nice. Everything fine, and we can execute the kernel, in this case only on a single thread because I ignore parallelization, check if everything is fine, and so it is. So let's allocate some memory on the CPU to verify it and copy back the data from GPU to CPU. I copy it. There's somewhere a typo.
It's just the N to an M.
Yeah.
Okay, no problem. I have a backup. And we can see 42. So you see pretty easy the first time. So it's so easy it is to execute some interactive function on the GPU. Okay, then. But I know not everyone likes to develop in a terminal. So the Kling CUDA mode is also working together with Jupyter Notebook. Both kernels are supported. So the kernel which is distributed with Kling and also the SUSE Kling kernel. There's only a modified version of the kernel JSON file necessary to enable it in Jupyter Notebook. And this notebooks represents our planned interactive workflow with simulations and analysis. So our main problem is that we have a really huge simulation, so Picon GPU running on a HPC system. For example, in the past, we used the whole Titan HPC system, and today we're running on Summit and so on. And our problem is on the one side, we generate petabytes of data with a single run, and it takes hours. And so it would be really nice if we can get some view inside the simulation during runtime, do some analysis on this, change the flow of the simulation, and all this without losing performance, because Pune GPU is really highly templated to achieve a really good performance, and this makes not possible to use, for example, Python and bindings. Okay, so at the begin, I include some helper libraries, for example, the libpng writer to generate PNGs from my data, which I can visualize on a notebook. And now I define the kernels. So the first one is just a helper kernel, and the second one is the main kernel. For my simulation, I use Game of Life. For everyone who don't know Game of Life, it's a particle, it's a stencil code. And so we have a 2D world, and each cell of the world has a state, dead or alive, and it's iterative. And depending on the living neighbors and the own state, it calculates for each new iteration the own new state. And this is done in this corner. So we calculate the own cell, count the living neighbors, and then depending on the own state and the living neighbors, we decide the next state. Okay, then we allocate memory on CPU and GPU, analyze the world. This is a small helper function, so I can easily define here this figure. And I read it in memory, copy it to GPU, and generate the initial image. And now we have the main loop with the CUDA calls. I execute it 5 times, and now we can watch the image. So this is now the normal workflow of a simulation. But in our case, maybe we see something pretty interesting. For example, this figure is called Glider, and the Glider has a special property that it has the same shape each fourth iteration, and only on other positions. So the original shape was like this mirrored L. And so it means after if we at iteration 8, we should get also this shape of the mirrored L. So it means we can do 3 extra iterations. And now we have the advantage. So if we have a really big simulation where iterations or many thousand iterations takes some time, for example, minutes or hours and so on, we don't want to redo this iteration. And now we don't need it because we have the state of the simulation at iteration 5 in our GPU memory, and we simply need to execute the iteration 6, 7, and 8. So we can save a lot of time. And if we execute it again, we see now that the simulation behaves like I expected. So this is pretty cool for the workflow of the simulation. And now we want to add some analysis. And this we can also do with this kernel simply counts the numbers of neighbors, and later I will visualize it on the on a heat map. And I can use, and then I allocate some extra memory because I want to use the simulation data as input of the function and write the result to the other bunch of memory, because I don't want to change some state of the simulation itself. So I can execute it, copy it to the GPU, generate the image, and visualize it. And now if I compare it with the visualization of the simulation, you can see, yes, this point has the most living neighbors. And this is also pretty cool because we can add and remove during runtime simulations. We can also write analysis. We can also write the analysis on runtime, which we didn't prepare before, depending on our results. And this enables pretty cool workflows. Okay, then, oh, sorry, I have to kill the kernel for the last demonstration. So in the last demonstration, I will show you what we can do with our Alpaca framework. So for this, I wrote a small matrix multiplication Alpaca. It looks like this. So we have the three loops And this code we can run on the CPU and GPU depending on the template type, so the TSSD. And then we have also some helper code to allocate memory and so on. And so we start the Kling again. Okay. Oh, and what is also pretty interesting, if you execute some, which is pretty interesting, so Kling itself becomes a CUDA application if it's executed some CUDA stuff. And at this, and if Kling becomes a CUDA application, you can see it in NVIDIA SMI, so it allocates some memory for the context. And you can also use other NVIDIA tools together with Kling, for example, MVProf or the new profiler. So during my presentation, you will see the first time I execute the code on CPU and then on GPU. So I need, okay. No. So for the demo, at first I include some special Alpaca headers, which simply enables the backend. In this case, means enable the CUDA backend, the CPU threads backend, which means execute the code in parallel via standard threads, and also the CPU serial backend, which simply means execute it on the CPU. This is more or less a fallback. Okay, then I include Alpaca itself. So it's a header only library and also the header file, which I showed you before. And now we can execute the function on CPU. So at first time serial. So I use the template parameter ACC CPU serial, and true simply means printing the result. Yeah. And if you write so many matrix multiplication like I, you will see this is the result of a matrix multiplication which is initialized from 0 to 15 and multiplied with the same matrix. So now let's increase a little bit the size of the matrix. Now we have a matrix 1600 by 6600. We parallelize it over one block and five by five threads. So the internal, it used the square product of each one. For the CPU back end, we can ignore blocks. That is just relevant for the GPU. And so we executed it on 25 threads. And you can see, okay, now my CPU is nearly full utilized and nothing is running on the GPU. And it takes some things. Now I can execute the same code on GPU, simply changing the template parameter and also increase a little bit the degree of parallelity because we have many weak cores. And the first thing what you see is it takes nearly a second. So it's simply much faster than the CPU version. So in this case, it makes sense to use the GPU. And then the other stuff which you now can see, there's the Kling application, which allocates 46 megabytes of RAM. And this is necessary for a context on the GPU. And now Kling is also a GPU application, a CUDA GPU application. Yeah. And we want to use this feature, this nice possibility, for example, to decide which kernel, which algorithm and which size is running pretty well on CPU or GPU during runtime, or also for debugging. For example, it's much easier to debug the algorithm on CPU than on GPU because GPU has no operation system. And so the tools are often not so mighty like on the CPU. Okay, then back to the presentation. So I want to finish with a small outlook. So what are my next tasks which I want to do? So I want to enable the CUDA mode in root because I heard that it's not possible. So it's not possible to run root X and minus X CUDA at the moment. I will find out what is the problem. I want to fix some bugs from the Alpaca demonstration because I had to work around some stuff. For example, that it works, you need to use the LVM C++ standard C++ implementation. I want to enable constant memory because I have already an idea how I can do this. Refactoring the compiler pipeline, that it's an inner class of Klingentopel, because during the upgrade to LVM9, I recognized this is the current design is not pretty nice to understand, and for future development not well suited. For example, if you want to support TIP or SIGIL and so on. And yes, yeah. And I announced Google Summer of Code project, which should add redefinition support for the CUDA mode. And hopefully we find a student, because this feature would be so cool. Yeah. And because Vasil asked last time at the D presentation, I also write a small wish list, what I want to wish for the Clang project or Clang Rebel. The first one is a GPU CI, because at the moment the CI does not cover CUDA. And also like a more general documentation, like maybe with Sphinx doc, like something the LVM user documentation, which simply describes the general concepts of Kling and link it together with the some codes of some parts of code, simply to get new people a better start with Kling. Okay, thanks for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Simeon. Really amazing work. I have so many questions that I don't know where to start, but does anybody else have questions or comments? Okay, maybe I can start. So you're saying about the GPU CI. So I know that David is looking into this, and yeah, we should probably follow up on that relatively soon.
Yeah, I heard it in a Sun meeting that Sun has already maybe some CI. Maybe we can use it.
Yes, we also have a CERN machine I know of. I'm not sure how much we can use it, but definitely at Princeton we have some GPUs that we can make use of this.
That is nice.
The other point on documentation, yes, I acknowledge that we need to somehow fix it. It's a long-term effort. I'm not sure that we can fix it for within a month or so, but definitely something that we need to improve. We used to have a Doxygen style documentation. I'm not sure what is its state. We had a nightly where it would make it like the Clang documentation. You do like make doc and then it would put it online. We used to have it some place online, but I'm not sure whether it's still available. I need to look on that again. I'll take a note. Okay, so I will limit myself to actually three questions. Have more, but so the when you say Clink size on the GPU, is that a constraint? Because you showed that it uses 56 megabytes of something that goes on the GPU. Is that a constraint?
Memory, I'm not sure if he can disable it. So I'm not pretty sure what this actually is. So it's a context which is enabled if you execute the application. I think it's for memory management, and also it depends on the GPU. So for example, in this case, I use the Tesla K20, which has only 5 gigabytes of RAM. So it's only 46 megabytes, and for the V100, the context is about 400 megabytes. But I believe it's possible to disable, but normally it makes no problem.
Okay. So I was targeting the question to, for example, is there a GPU where this 50 or 60 or I don't know how many megabytes becomes like problematic? And if not, then that's fine, because no. I think I also want to decrease the amount of startup time of startup memory of Kling, and we know how, mostly to fit that case where we go on embedded systems.
Okay. So this is something which is a problem on the CUDA side. For example, if I execute the first time, the CUDA get last error. So this context is initialized in the driver and so on. And this takes about a second. And if I do the command again, so it's nearly immediately the result. So I think this is something which we can't control.
Okay. And on the root minus six thing, please feel free to ping me offline if you need help on this. We used to, if you want to pass information within root to startup, we have this environmental variable called clink underscore x underscore args, and then you can pass it. But I'm not sure whether that's going to trigger an earthquake or something like that. So
I already saw that in the Jupyter kernel that I have to pass also over environment variable the minus executor. Yeah. It's okay. This is interesting to know. So I will try it with this. Maybe then
I would not advertise it, but this is a way how you can pipe things within root to the clean driver.
Okay. There's no other option because you have also sometimes you have also set up other stuff. For example, where is the CUDA SDK living? If it's not on user local.
Yeah, it can take an arbitrary set of options. So it's not only one. It can just space separated thing and it would just use it. So the caveat there is that root is very picky on the environment which is built and the environment which runs. So that's why we are hiding most of the options and we try to be as close as to what the root was built with. And that's why we kind of export the compile time environment and then pipe it to Clink so that we can avoid ABI and other problems. But CUDA is a little bit of a different beast. So use that and then we will see how we can support it. The other point that I wanted to say is that, so you are saying, in your presentation, you outlined like three bullets. On the first thing is teaching within CUDA and Clink. And the second bullet was the big interactive simulation with GPUs. So do you need, so what would it take to make that happen? Do you need extra support on the Clink side? What's missing?
At the moment, so Picon GPU is basing on Alpaca. So the first goal would be to achieve that Alpaca is running. And so most problems are just engineering tasks. For example, enable some features. Also, it solves some bugs and so on. So for example, I had no time until yet, but I don't know why, but I can execute a CUDA function, Alpaca function at the moment only once time on the GPU. After this, I get a really strange error, so I can present this. And I have no idea what's this. And it's nearly every time the same. So first I get a strange bug, then I look in the code and try to find out what is going wrong. And if I understand what is going wrong, most of the time it's not really hard to fix it. So it's simply spending more time will solve the problems. So at the moment I do not missing something in special from Clink side.
Okay, that's good to hear. And last question. So what is there some sort of a heuristics where you can say by looking at the code at static time, which is going to likely be a good fit for a GPU? Is there such a thing? Because I feel like you have a good feeling about this, and I'm not talking about matrices. If you want to multiply matrices, it's pretty clear that the GPU is always faster. But if you look at the code, say, I don't know, the signature or like somehow the data sizes or something like that, can you kind of have that heuristic?
Yes and no. So it's not some fixed values where I can say, okay, now I move to this and back and so on. There are some more or less lazy rules, like one rule is if you touch only a date once time, it makes no sense to copy it to the GPU. And also the sizes are a little bit depend. So especially for matrix multiplication, I know. So normally it makes no sense to send a matrix which is smaller than 1000 by 1000 to the GPU. But this depends also a little bit on the problem. So it's not really a strict rule or heuristic. It's more or less best practice.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Any more questions? Okay,
I think a very, very quick question just about shipping. Do you plan to coordinate the release of this with the package management in CPT or with the XUS people so that people like can easily get a CUDA enabled Kling like from Conda or something like this to get a word out?
That's a good question. This is something what I want to discuss with Sylvian because some feature, I don't know if it's still implemented in XUS Kling, but what be would cool if we can restart our interpreter instance with new arguments. For example, at the moment I have in my normal development I have six or nine different kernels because I have XUS Kling with C++ 11, 14, 17 with CUDA and without, and so. So it becomes really fast, really complicated. And you need also to enable some stuff, for example, OpenMP and so on. And this is maybe something I want to discuss if it's possible, if we can implement a magic command which simply says restart the interpreter with this arguments.
Yeah, that sounds good.
I'm not sure. Maybe it's also possible with the Kling kernel. With the kernel developed by Kling.
Yeah. And the other question, maybe someone knows that it's attending, is does CPT need updates for this that we would care about? Is this like, do we need extra flex for CUDA?
Normally not. So I believe I already fixed this in CPT. I have to test it again, but in the end, the only requirement to have Kling with CUDA support is building the MVPDX backend. And normally this should be done by default, so because it's not really big. And then,
And so let me underline this. This is super cool, right? So Simeon made it such that you don't actually need any of the NVIDIA development libraries to build Kling with the CUDA backend.
To be honest, this is the work of the Kling LVM community. So the Kling also, so the, I believe that if you download the normal Kling, it's not via APT or so on, the Kling should be also able to compile some CUDA code if the SDK is available.
But they can't run it, so that's not the same.
Yes, you can also run it without the SDK, but then you get some really nice error messages.
So you cannot run it.
Yes. Maybe we can hide this in the future. There are some really interesting stuff working at the moment. And sometimes for development, it's enough. For example, for some times where all NVIDIA workstation was crashed, I developed on the AMD system. So this was also no problem.
That's very cool. Cool, thank you very much for the updates.
Yeah, you're welcome.
More questions?
Yeah, I have one very general. We've seen like a lot of slowdown in CUDA doing like JIT when we're compiling like shaders. I'm curious, do you see any of that in this use like of startup time or anything that the CUDA is kind of the first invocation of it somehow takes a moment longer than you would like?
Yeah. So in theory, so if you JIT the code, so it makes a difference if you use the shard library or if you do it directly. So if you directly JIT code, so it makes no difference. So the only problem is at the moment the compilation is not lazy, so you have to wait for big corners. Yeah. Oh, and I forgot to tell some background. So in Qtar we have two stages for everybody who don't know. We have two stages of JITting. So one is generating the PDX code, and then there is a second stage in the driver which compiles the PDX code to just in time to actually machine code. And you can speed up this on a static application with some options. So for example, you can generate PDX code for a minimum architecture. So it means you can execute this code on the GPUs which fulfill this minimum requirement and are better. And you can also compile this for a specific graphic cards. In this case, then the code executes must fast as possible. But in the context of just JITting the code and interactively, yes, you cannot save the time because you type in the code during the process. You can only try to use pre-compiled stuff via shared libraries and so on.
Maybe one bit of information. In the LVM 12 or whatever, 13, the JIT is split into two parts. So there is a compilation and the execution. So theoretically, we can compile in O2 a run so that we avoid the process of waiting for the compilation. And then at the background, in a separate thread, compile to O2 and then switch the function to the one that's optimized. And this would be almost coming out of the box with the Orc V2 JIT, which I will probably start moving still this year. I don't know whether that would help.
I see it. Just a question about this. But the main pass and so is still running in the same process like the main thread of Kling or not?
Yes, we have had a discussion with Lang about that. So we have three Google Summer of Code projects on making the JIT run out of process. So the JIT code is going to be JIT out of the process. Lang claims that it is supported today, but through the remote procedure calls and it's slow. So the proper implementation would be to have like shared memory and then have the JIT out of the process so that you can remove all those segmentation faults that we see.
Yeah, this would be pretty nice because this is one of the problems which I see really often, that the Kling is crashing with a segmentation fault because of embedded code.
Yeah, it's on the LVM, on Compiler Research Open Projects page. Those are three projects and they're also published in the LVM Open Projects tab. So you can take a look what we sort of think it would be useful, but also it boils down to finding the right candidate. If you have somebody that has the knowledge about shared memory and POSIX and all this kind of stuff, and he's looking for some project, maybe we should try to actively reach out to them so that they can do something for us. Otherwise, just sitting and waiting for somebody to show up is maybe not the most efficient.
Yeah, but on the other side, that kind of people are really hard to get.
Yes, agreed. More questions. We are a little bit late. I would say we will skip the round table, but if there are more questions for Simeon or somebody else. If not, thanks Simeon again. It was a really amazing presentation. A lot to learn. I have quite a bit of homework now. And thanks a lot everybody for showing up. So take care and see you back then. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, thank you.
Bye. Bye.